Good afternoon. You are most welcome in this place as we come to give thanks for Alan. Shall we just have a short prayer as we begin? Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, by his resurrection of Christ from the dead, he gave us new birth into a living hope, the hope of an inheritance reserved in heaven for you, which nothing can destroy or spoil or wither. Blessed are you, sovereign God, ruler and judge of all. To you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of this age that is passing away, may the glory of your kingdom, which the saints enjoy, surround our steps as we journey on. And may we reflect the light of your glory this day, and so be made ready to come into your presence. Our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, blessed be God, forever. Amen. Sisters and brothers in Christ, we meet as the community of faith to worship God as we proclaim our resurrection faith and to give thanks for our dear brother Alan, to remember his life amongst us and to uphold and support those who mourn. The order will be as presented in your order of service, and it's a delight to hear Poppy come and play our opening piano piece. Thank you. Thank you very much to Poppy. We're going to stand as we are able, as we sing, Praise my soul, the King of heaven, to his feet thy tribute bring. Let us praise our God as we come to him in prayer. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the King of glory, the eternal Son of the Father. When you took our flesh to set us free, you humbly chose the Virgin's womb. You overcame the sting of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. For you are seated at God's right hand in glory. We believe that you will come to be our judge. Come then, Lord, and help your people, bought with the price of your own blood, and bring us with your saints to glory everlasting. As we walk our own pilgrimage, may you lead us by your Holy Spirit. The faith that we walk through, in holiness and righteousness all our days. And we thank you, Holy God, for the love and care that we receive in times of sorrow. We ask that you will grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care. May they have the strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope and the joyful expectation of eternal life with those whom they love. Lord God, we thank you for the love and the fellowship that we shared with Alan. We thank you for just who he was, his humility and his kindness, his willingness to serve and his faith in you. We ask that you will continue to join your faithful people in one communion and fellowship. Give us the grace to follow your blessed saints in all virtuously and godly living, that we may come to those inexpressible joys which you have prepared for all who love you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to hear a number of readings, first from our Bible passages, which John and Yvonne will lead, and then from Chris, a couple of poems, and then we will finish as we watch Trees by Joyce Kilmer. But first of all, I would invite the Reverend John Young. Thank you.
First, I'm going to read from the St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let's not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. I'm going to read one verse out of the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The family found a small slip of paper in the last week or two, and these words were written on it. Alan had written them. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Thanks be to God for those readings from his word.
A familiar song, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Abu ben Adam, may his tribe increase. I'm not feeling very good, actually. Apologies for that dramatic intervention. Do you know where I got to? I don't know where I got to. Only just started, okay. I think it's because this reading meant a lot to me, and it just got to my heart. But anyway. Yeah, please. Yeah. Abu ben Adam, may his tribe increase. I woke one night from a deep dream of peace and saw within the moonlight in his room, making it rich and like a... No. Gosh.
Abu bin Adam, may his tribe increase, awoke one night from a deep dream of peace, and saw within the moonlight in his room, making it rich and like a lily in bloom, an angel writing in a book of gold. Exceeding peace had made Ben Adam bold, and to the presence in the room he said, "What writest thou?" Vision raised its head, and with a look made of sweet accord, answered, "The names of those who love the Lord." "And mine is, and is mine one?" said Abu. "Nay, not so," replied the angel. Abu spoke more low, but cheerily still, and said, "I pray thee then, write me as one that loves his fellow men." The angel wrote and vanished. The next night it came again with a great wakening light and showed the names whom God of love had blessed. And lo, Ben Adam's name led all the rest.
Look at the front of your booklets, and just behind Alan's head you'll see a music system, and if you could, you look over to the left hand side of him, you'd see a old school stereogram, and he had a fantastic collection of old 78. records. So this poem called The Stereogram was written after going around to visit Alan and listening to this amazing old system. Lives meet like cogs in a machine. They mesh briefly and then time moves on. But I never guessed I'd lose you quite so soon. So soon, my friend. Had I known, would I have been more keen? Watching you place three discs like a stack of stiff black pancakes on the central pole. I'm going again. Oh.
Like a stack of stiff black pancakes on the central pole. The fumble for the hole, the clattering and then the swift, startling function of the mechanism. The loud slap as the record hits the mat. The arm and the needle shoot across and music starts instantly. An unexpected warmth comes through the speakers. Lovely bass, delicious valve-driven tone. We both react with laughter, your pride and joy, a moment shared and savoured. Now you have gone, what's changed? The smiling, gentle presence that helped me feel something special in your world, that stepped me briefly out of mine. Oh, Alan, the cogs turn. Important moments end, but we never ever guessed we'd lose you quite so soon, my friend. So we'll just take a moment. We're going to stand as we are able, as we sing, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, a powerful song that sings my soul, my Saviour God to thee.
Thank you.
seated. One of the things about we come to celebrate a life is to remember some of those things that give life to that individual. And there'll be stories that you'll have brought today that you will just be holding at the moment about Alan and the times that you've spent with him. But it's a delight to welcome Angela from Holy Moorside Choral Society. And then we'll have some words from the Centre Point run by Reg and Kay Rodder. But first we start with Angela. Thank you.
I am here today, along with other members of Holy Moorside Choral Society, to pay tribute to Alan, who was part of the choir for many years. I seem to recall he was already a member when I started 32 years ago. Alan joined the society after a chance meeting with Bill Maiden, our musical director at the time, who quickly recruited him into the tenors. Once a member, Alan was equally as good at enticing new members to the choir, even recruiting his own GP. John Thurston, a fellow tenor, was made to feel welcome by Alan when he joined the choir in the early 1990s. John remembers him as supportive and helpful, with an inexhaustible supply of sweets to share during choir practice. During his time with the choir, Alan sat on the committee, and we thank him and Barbara for their hospitality when the committee met at their house. Before he retired from the choir, he handed over to me the job of picking readers every year to perform in our wassail concert. He relished collecting suitable passages to be read aloud, or vetting people's own choices when he asked them to take part. He passed that enthusiasm on to me, which I still greatly enjoy. Tributes from other choir members described Alan as a lovely man, enthusiastic, interesting to talk to, and unfailingly faithful in his support of the choir, even after he had retired from singing. Our current musical director described him as a devoted groupie when Alan and Barbara became part of the audience at our concerts. We thank you, Alan.
A lot of you here today will have known Alan and Barbara a lot longer than myself and my husband Reg, but we didn't want this occasion to go by without publicly acknowledging commitment and time that Alan gave as treasurer to Centre Point. This was originally set up in 1988 as a day centre in what was then the new hall where we were joined for refreshments downstairs. This was to be used to provide facilities for recreation and social contact for members of our community and from our church family. A management committee was formed and a treasurer was found. Initially it was Bill Hardwick, but within a short period of time, Alan took on the responsibility of managing the accounts. The day centre ran for many years on 2 days of the week, Tuesdays and Wednesdays. A supervisor initially steering this new venture, and Reg and I took over in 2018 when Anne Galloway retired in 2018, reducing the 2 days just down to one, just a Tuesday. During all this time, Alan as treasurer steered Centre Point with his efficiency and fundraising, obtaining grants wherever he was able to. Barbara and Alan, during this long period, attended regularly, volunteering, and when reopened as a lunch club after COVID, they both continued to support us. Alan sat with friends eating his sandwiches and could be seen regularly tucking into a hot pudding that was on offer every Tuesday. He would always brighten people's day with a story or a good book he had recently read, along with recollections of yesteryear. He kept me on track with the accounts, ensuring that our financial status was sound, and we would like to say a grateful thank you to Alan for his loyal and efficient service of 30 years standing as Treasurer of Centrepoint. He will be missed greatly by us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Kay. We also have some contributions from Keith Deakin, John Whittam, John and Esther McDonald of Terminus Bowling Club as well. John says, Alan was the first man I played bowls with when I joined the Terminus. To say he was a nice guy is putting it mildly. I did not know a thing about bowls, and Alan took me to one side and showed me how it was played. He was a lovely guy and will be sadly missed. From Keith, the club secretary. I personally only joined the club last season and have taken on the role of secretary at the end of that season. However, I remember when I first saw Alan turn up to the club last year after I believe an illness had happened. Everyone was happy to see him and he made the effort to speak to everybody. He came and sat with me and made an effort He made an effort to remember mine and all the new players' names, and it was a delight to chat with him about all sorts of things. He made me smile when we were working hard in installing the new guttering, and not many members of the club turned out to help, but Alan turned up and said, I am unable to do any of the hard work, but I can make the tea. I used this quote to send out to all the club members who failed to help, to shame them, saying that even Alan turns out when the work is required. And from John and Esther McDonald. John and I haven't known Alan for long in the history of him bowling. He was always a lovely, lovely gentleman in every sense of the word. He loved his family and was always ready to talk about his wife and children. As regards his bowling, he loved it. If up against Alan on a Monday or a Friday social bowling afternoons, you knew that if he was on song with his line and length, you didn't stand a chance. Some lovely memories of the bowling club there. And so to the eulogy from the family, thank you ever so much for putting this together. As you know, Alan was a Geordie, born in Newcastle upon Tyne, when his older brother Brian was but 2 years old, with his sister Val to follow. His brother and cousins have shared memories of a happy childhood. Alan went to primary school in Gateshead, and then the family later moved to Fenham in Newcastle, where Alan went to Pendawa Secondary Commercial School, studying such subjects as commerce, bookkeeping, shorthand and typing, and making some great friends, several of whom were also called Alan. He used to joke that when the teacher called Alan, half the class would turn around. He was sporty in his youth, a fast short-distance runner. He enjoyed playing badminton and cricket, a sport that would prove key in his later life, and used to go swimming at the local bath on a Saturday morning with his pal, Alan Greener. He enjoyed walking all his life. Alan's cousin Judith recalls, I have so many good memories of Alan from when I was a child, and he was so kind to me, especially giving me rides on his bike to the bus stop and organising a picnic for me when I was staying at my mother's house with a broken leg. And Alan was always so cheerful and considerate to a probably annoying young cousin, and I loved him dearly. Alan's older brother Brian recalls sharing a double bed with Alan for a long time growing up. That was actually until Brian got married and moved out. They used to argue about trespassing on each other's halves, defining territory by referring to the headboard, which had a carving right in the middle. He remembers they used to speak to their Auntie Joyce every week, and she would ask them if they could recall people's names for her, and they would eventually work it out between them. They had happy memories of family holidays in Scarborough twice a year, Easter and 2 weeks in the summer, staying at the same boarding house where they were made to feel very welcome. There were visits to the open-air theatre. Brian recalled their sister Valerie being a poor traveller and often having to have someone walk with her for half a mile or so across the moors to recover, sometimes in the snow of Easter. Occasionally there would be an extra trip in September for their dad Ron's benefit to the Scarborough Cricket Festival. Brian remembers Alan teaching him to drive in Alan's car immediately after Alan had passed his test only 6 weeks previously. He remembered Alan's bank colleague helping him to buy his first 1939 Standard 12 motor car. And not long after, Brian, his wife Betty, two-year-old son Christopher and Alan all travelled to Scotland together on holiday, with Brian and Alan sharing the driving. Quite an undertaking, with driving being more demanding in that type of a car. Alan was always good with numbers. He could reel off all the number plates of all the cars he'd ever had, and of his father's cars too. Alan joined the NatWest Bank at 17 and stayed with them all his working life, starting off in various branches in and around Newcastle. He did his 2 years national service, telling us that he got his call-up papers on his 19th birthday. He talked about his time in Bridgnorth and Syston, recalling hitching home to Newcastle to see his folks, remembering the times he got lucky with a long distance lift or got dropped off almost at the door, his dad giving him a lift to catch the late train back to base and seeing the same fellas getting on the train at different stations along the way back. Alan was later transferred to Lincoln, where he found digs and a cricket team to play in. It was at a cricket match that he met Barbara in 1966, the cricket grounds being in the park behind her home. He used to enjoy telling the story of how they met, and we used to enjoy hearing it. He used to say that meeting Barbara was the best thing he'd ever did. They were courting for only 4 months before he was transferred to the Chesterfield branch, so he would drive over to Lincoln on weekends and stay with Barbara's auntie so he and Barbara could see each other. Alan and Barbara had married in Lincoln in July 1968. They moved into a house on Somersault Lane in Chesterfield, where they got to know neighbours who remained good friends for many years, including Joe Hill. Helen and Joanne arrived, both born at home. Alan was the first to see them. He used to joke that Helen had arrived just in time for tea, at 4:15 in the afternoon. Helen and Joe remember him teaching them how to ride a bike and how to clean a bike. I don't know how he convinced them that that was really good fun, really. He gave us a gentle lesson in taking pride, bringing out the shine on the chrome. Being dragged out, well, that was how it felt sometimes as a youngster, on weekend walks in the Derbyshire countryside. Really loved going up Froggatt's Edge with our Afghan hound, Tanya, and we both enjoy walking now, as Dad did. His love of old films, which he passed on, It's a Wonderful Life being a particular favourite. Playing cards and games, Newmarket was a traditional one for the evenings on holiday in sea houses. Doing his riffle shuffle and saying his magic word to summon the good cards into his own hand. He was known in the family for winning any raffle he entered, like the playgoers events raffles, often scooping more than one prize. The most memorable win has to be on a family holiday in sea houses, one of many annual trips there, staying at a friend's holiday home each year, where Alan bought tickets in the RNLI raffle, the prize being an enormous whole salmon. When there was a knock at the door, he joked, "That'll be my salmon," and sure enough it was. An emergency dash to see his sister Val followed to ask her to stash it in her freezer and had to share it with her. From sea houses, he enjoyed visits to the Farne Islands, Bamburgh, Holy Island, Alnwick, and particularly Craster for the famous kippers. Walking along the pier at sea houses one day, he encountered Peter Andrews doing a spot of fishing. Another time there, he was hailed with, "That's Alan Rowland," and turned to found a school friend he hadn't seen for many years. Travels with Barbara later included cruising on the Rhine and the Danube, taking the Glacier Express in Switzerland, visiting Helen in Montpellier, Barcelona and Tarragona, and in Nepal, where he amazed and maybe scared Barbara by going tandem paragliding. He enjoyed spending time with Joe, Ben, Emily and Poppy in their Herefordshire house, and visiting their woodland. Alan loved his career in the bank, especially his time at Tideswell, where he was branch accountant, and later at Darleydale, where he was appointed branch manager. He took great pride in his staff team, who won a National Customer Service Award. He gave his team the credit and told them so. He gave honest advice, serving customers' best interests and bringing in a lot of business for the bank. He felt lucky to enjoy his work and to work with a great team. In the snowy weather, getting to the bank and back home again required some determination. He would drive through the snow in his little van. Once he was forced to abandon it en route at the Highwayman in Eastmoor and walk over 4 miles from there to get home. He recalled working at Ashover Branch once a week with a colleague and getting a pie and a pint delivered to the bank for lunch. He enjoyed a long retirement from the age of 56 after a career of 39 years. He seemed quite amazed that he'd been retired almost as long as he'd been working, but he loved meeting up with his old bank colleagues and sharing a meal together. His memberships of Holy Moorside Choral Society and the Terminus Bowling Club were both an important part of his life for many years, for the activities themselves and the friendships he found there. He was always sociable, enjoyed a chat and a joke. He loved getting together with old school friends from Pendawa at a 40-year school reunion in Newcastle. The second reunion was an even bigger adventure, taking place in the USA, where a couple of his friends lived, going to Los Angeles. He loved his granddaughters, Em, Poppy and Lily, and he lived in Chesterfield for over 55 years. But his love of the Northeast endured. His Geordie accent would come out particularly when chatting to his brother on the phone, which we loved to hear. He used to call us all pet, and the children were the bens. He entertained friends at playgoers with his Geordie dialect humorous readings at social evenings and at Centrepoint too. He always loved to chat with a fellow Geordie. Alan developed epilepsy in his 40s. It was well managed for the rest of his life, but perhaps affected him more than he had to take a break from driving. Good friends gave him lifts to work. He enjoyed good health until his later years. He had prided himself on his excellent attendance record at both school and at work. He liked to get out for his daily constitutional, noticing dates on buildings, even better, stopping for a bit of a chat and reporting back once home. He was taking pleasure in doing the ordinary things he enjoyed to the end of his life, driving, getting out for a walk every day, even the day before he died, albeit a short and slow one, enjoying a pie at his favourite cafe, appreciating living in a lovely house where he enjoyed Barbara's garden and her cooking, sharing music and memories with friends and family. He will be warmly remembered as a Geordie, a Newcastle supporter, a bank manager, a bowler, a singer, a driver, a theatre-goer, a walker, a husband, a father, a brother, a granddad, a neighbour and a friend. In the many cards so kindly sent by family and friends, the same words come up time and again. What a kind and caring, lovely man. A true gentleman, cheerful and welcoming, knowledgeable and good company, generous, loyal and gentle, and we will miss him. Thank you for those words from everybody. We're just going to take a moment so that you may have a time to think about your own stories about Alan, some of those memories perhaps invoked from what has already been said, as we watch a piece by Carl Jenkins with some photos. please do continue to join in celebrating Alan's life in the stories that you share over refreshments after we finish here today. For those stories go on. They go on not because the person has left, but because the person lived, because the person gave to us so much that we need to share in the times that we have together. But we're going to draw our time here to a close as we sing All Things Bright and Beautiful, All Creatures Great and Small. Please stand as you are able as we sing our final hymn together. So, Lord God, grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the world peace, and to us and all the faithful life everlasting, and the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with us all, now and forever. Amen.
Hear me, little Jackie, no, I've smoked me bucky, have a bit of cracky till the boat comes in. Dance to the daddy, sing to the mammy, dance to the daddy, to the mammy sing. Thou shalt have a fishy and a little ishy, thou shalt have a fishy when the boat comes in.
Hear me,
Here's the mother humming like a canny woman. Yonder comes the father, drunk he cannot stand. Dance to the daddy, sing to the mammy. Dance to the daddy, to the mammy sing. Thou shalt have a fishy, earn a little dishy. Thou shalt have a haddock when the boat comes in. Was fuddling, he's so fond of ale, but he's kind to me, I hope he'll never fail. Dance to the daddy, sing to the mammy, dance to the daddy, to the mammy sing. Thou shalt have a fishy, earn a little dishy, thou shalt have a bloater when the boat comes in. Like a drop myself when I can get it sly, although me body bear will like it as well as I. Dance to the daddy, sing to the mammy, dance to the daddy, to the mammy sing. Thou shalt have a fishy, earn a little dishy, thou shalt have a mackerel when the boat comes in. May we get a drop oft as we stand in need, and we'll may the kill row that brings the bairns a breed. Dance to the daddy, sing to the mammy, dance to the daddy, to the mammy sing. Thou shalt have the fishy on a little dishy, thou shalt have the fishy when the boat comes in. Thou shalt have the fishy on a little dishy, thou shalt have a haddock when the boat comes in. Thou shalt have the fishy on a little dishy, thou shalt have the bloater when the boat comes in. Thou shalt have the fishy on a little dishy, thou shalt have a mackerel when the boat comes in. Thou shalt have